Namaskar students, for class 11th you have two textbooks in English. One is Hornbill and second is Snapshots. So we will begin with Hornbill first. Today we are going to take a chapter from the prose section, namely The Portrait of a Lady, and it is written by Khushwant Singh. So before starting the chapter, let me tell you something about the author. Khushwant Singh was born on 2nd February 1915. He was an Indian novelist, lawyer, journalist and a politician. He studied law at St. Stephen's College, Delhi and King's College, London. Then after working as a lawyer in Lahore Court for 8 years, he joined Indian Foreign Services. He was appointed as a journalist in All India Radio in 1951. He was decorated with the Padma Bhushan Award in 1974, but he returned the award in 1984 in protest against the Operation Blue Star, in which the Indian Army raided Amritsar. He died on 20th March 2014. So now let's begin with the chapter. The Portrait of a Lady is part of an autobiography by Khushwant Singh. In this story, the author draws a pen portrait of his grandmother. He beautifully unfolds their relationship and how it undergoes several changes. In other words, we can say that the story gives us a picture of human relationships. It is a realistic account of how the grandparents give all their time, attention, and love to their grandchildren. By the end of the story, you all will realize that this story is a loving tribute from a grandson to his grandmother. In the beginning of the chapter, the author remembers his grandmother and grandfather. The author recalls his grandmother as a very old lady. For the 20 years that the author had known his grandmother, he had found her old and wrinkled. It was hard for him to believe that she had once been young and pretty, and she had a husband. Khushwant Singh's grandfather's portrait hung on the wall of the drawing room. He wore a big turban, his clothes were loose, he looked at least 100 years old. Looking at his portrait, no one could imagine him in his youth with his wife and children. He looked as if he could only have lots and lots of grandchildren. The thought of the grandmother being young and pretty was almost revolting to him. She was short, fat, and slightly bent in stature. Her face was a crisscross of wrinkles. Her silvery white hair was scattered over her wrinkled face. The author remembered her hobbling around the house in spotless white clothes with one hand resting on her waist to balance her stoop and the other hand busy counting the beads of her rosary. Her lips constantly moved in audible prayer. To the author, she could never have been pretty, but she reflected a divine beauty. She was like the winter landscape in the mountains. The author and his grandmother were good friends. His parents left him to stay with her when they shifted to the city. In the village, his grandmother took care of all his needs. She was quite active. She used to wake him up in the morning and get him ready for the school. She said her morning prayers in a sing-song manner while she dressed him, in the hope that her grandson would learn them by heart. The author listened to the prayers because he loved her voice, but he never bothered to learn them. Then she would fetch his wooden slate, which she had already washed. She would take an earthen ink pot and a pen and tie them in a bundle and hand it to the author. After having a thick stale chapati with a little butter and sugar spread on it for breakfast, they used to leave for the school. The author's grandmother always accompanied him to the school, as it was attached to the temple. At the village school, the priest taught the children the alphabet and the morning prayer. The children sat in two rows in the veranda. They would sing the alphabet or their prayer in a chorus. While the author learned his lessons at school, the grandmother would read scriptures in the adjoining temple. And on their way back, they would feed stale chapatis to the dogs. Now children, pay attention. This is the very important part of the chapter, that what was the turning point in their friendship. When the author's parents got comfortably settled in the city, they called for them. The turning point came in their relationship when they moved to the city. In the city, the author went to an English school in a motor bus. The grandmother could not accompany him to the school. As there were no dogs in the streets, the grandmother took to feeding the sparrows. As the years rolled by, with the passage of time, they saw less of each other. Though they shared the same room, but conversations were less. In spite of her immense interest in his studies, she could not help him in the lessons as he was learning English, the law of gravity, Archimedes' principle, the world being around, and many more such things which she could not understand. And this made her unhappy. Sometimes she would ask him what the teacher had taught him, but she was unable to understand anything. Grandmother didn't believe in the things taught at the English school and was distressed to learn that there was no teaching about the God and the scriptures in the school. Moreover, she was very disturbed at the idea of music lessons being given at the English school. To her, music had lewd associations. It was the monopoly of harlots and beggars and not meant for gentle folk. She said nothing, but her silence meant disapproval. After that, she rarely talked to author. Now the common link of friendship gets snapped. Snapped means broken. The common link was broken between the author and the grandmother when the author went to the university, and this time he was given a room of his own. The grandmother accepted her loneliness and rarely spoke to anyone. All the day long, she sat spinning the wheel, means the beads of rosary, and reciting her prayers. Only in the afternoon, she relaxed for a while to feed the sparrows. They perched on her shoulders and some even on her head, but she never shooed them away. It used to be the happiest half hour of the day for her. The author decided to go abroad for higher studies for 5 long years. He was sure that his grandmother would be upset at his departure. But she was not even sentimental. She came to see him off at the railway station, but she didn't say anything. She showed no emotion. She was absorbed in praying and counting the beads of her rosary. Silently, she kissed his forehead. The author thought that perhaps it was the last sign of physical contact between them, as the grandmother was getting older and older. After 5 years, the author found his grandmother at the station when he returned. She held him in her arms. She was looking very happy. He found her more religious and more self-contained that time. He could hear her reciting prayers. But even that day, the happiest moment for her was feeding the sparrows herself. However, something strange happened to her in the evening. And what was the strange thing that evening? For the first time ever, she did not pray. Instead, she collected the women of the neighborhood, got an old drum, and started to sing songs of the homecoming of warriors. They tried to persuade her to stop, avoid overstraining herself, but she didn't listen. As a result, she fell ill the next morning. According to doctor, it was a mild fever, and he said that she would be fine. But the grandmother thought differently. She insisted that her end was near. She told everyone that she did not want to talk to anyone and would rather spend her last moments in praying. She ignored everyone's protests and started counting the beads in her rosary while praying. After a short while, the author noticed that his grandmother's lips stopped moving and the rosary fell from her lifeless fingers. She died a peaceful death. Grandmother's body was lifted off the bed and laid on the ground and covered with a red shawl, as it was customary. After a few hours of mourning, she was left alone in the room as rest of the family members were busy in making arrangements for her funeral. In the evening, when author and others came to her room to take away her body, they saw a strange sight. To mourn her death, a lot of sparrows had surrounded the grandmother's body. They all were silent. There was no chirruping. Everybody felt sorry for the birds, and his mother fetched some bread for them. She broke it into little pieces the way the grandmother used to do and threw them to the birds. But the sparrows took no notice of the bread. They all flew away quietly when the grandmother's body was carried away for the last rite. This was definitely a tribute paid by the sparrows to the grandmother. So children, this was the chapter, The Portrait of a Lady, written by Khushwant Singh. I hope you all have understood that how it is a loving tribute from a grandson to his grandmother. Thank you.